Brilliant ideas, powered by Hyundai Motor.
Thomas Struth is one of the most important and influential photographic artists of our time. From urban landscapes and public spaces to family portraits or perplexing high-tech environments, Struth's work scrutinizes the world that surrounds us and raises probing questions about the achievements, aspirations, and evolution of humanity.
His works are monumental, they are carefully composed, and they hold a universal truth.
He's transcended that thing of just being a great photographer. There is something unique and very special about when you look at those images.
He blurs the boundaries between what we see as photography and what we understand as art.
There is a tendency to believe that a photograph is the truth. And I think Thomas' work, in a way, questions that.
There's a coolness in that photography, which is not inhuman, but it puts humans in their place.
The first thing that needs to be there is a reason. I don't go out just photographing something that I find visually attractive. I have a strong desire of reaching out and talking to a big audience in a general manner where we can share something.
Thomas is perhaps best known for his portrait of the Queen of England and Duke of Edinburgh, commissioned in 2011 for her Diamond Jubilee.
I thought about, I'm not going to photograph her in the kitchen. She's the Queen. And I stupidly said to them, I know it's not so enjoyable to be photographed. And she said, well, we have some experience.
I think my favorite is of the Queen. It has all the details of her status, and it's very royal. But then there's something about the stockings that's also very, very real and very human.
That particular portrait for me is not so important in my work because it's kind of an exotic experience, and the whole thing lasted, I think, 25 minutes.
History is a prominent theme in Struth's work. And his own personal history growing up in Dusseldorf in post-World War II Germany had a profound effect on his early artistic inclinations.
I was born in 1954, which was like 9 years after the war. My father was a soldier in the fascist army. He got shot twice and he barely survived. My mother was a potter. She loved the arts. After the war, people in Germany, I think, were very much trying to link themselves back to conventions, your family life and order and sort of peaceful and being normal, which of course doesn't exist. And I found that very suffocating in a certain way. So I think that's one of the reasons why you intuitively got very attracted by the arts. My favorite subject was partly with architecture and with human figure. When I applied at the Academy of Dusseldorf later on, that was what I gave in as my portfolio. It were paintings and drawings.
Struth's drawings were impressive enough to gain him entry into the Dusseldorf Academy of Art, where he studied under world-renowned artist Gerhard Richter.
In Richter's class, the atmosphere was strictly oriented within the art world. During that time, I had started already to look at photographs and use parts of compositions for my drawings and paintings. So I started to work with the camera. I photographed and I still painted, but the paintings became more realistic and I didn't feel like becoming a photorealist painter.
Picking up on his frustration, Richter guided Struth to the Academy's School of Photography, run by acclaimed industrial landscape photographers Bernd and Hiller Becker.
The bachelors bought a large format camera that we had to share. That was a very different thing because all of a sudden everybody started to have to work with a tripod and a dark cloth. So it was really picture making practice of a very different kind.
Inspired by the camera's ability to capture detail, Thomas began photographing city streets in his hometown of Dusseldorf.
The street scene in Dusseldorf had this kind of strangely disrupted pattern of atmosphere, and that was what the Nazis did and what its consequences were.
Dusseldorf was one of these cities that were heavily destroyed and then rebuilt in the 50s. It becomes a more modern city, but it also has scars that are still there today. All this is visible for me in the structure of his cityscapes, and I think he has a very great sensibility to pick up on the history of things that are visible in one moment.
His street scenes rarely have people in them. He was very aware of the kind of silence that reigned not just in the streets but across a whole generation that had been traumatized by the war and wasn't talking about it.
The emotional quality of post-war Germany was so conflicted emotionally that to which there was no exit.
In 1977, Thomas did find an exit when he received a scholarship for the Museum of Modern Art's PS1 studio in New York City. It was a moment that would change his life and expand his opportunities as an artist.
When I arrived in New York, I was quite shocked about the atmosphere of the city, and I felt very intimidated. There's a lot of homeless people. It feels very dangerous and very dramatic. The first 4 weeks, I couldn't really speak. I was like, First time I put my camera on one of these crazy guys, it's like tried to attack me in the middle of the street, and I was like, oh my God, this is really what I expected. I made the choice from the central perspective, to just simply treat these two sides of the street equal. So different things you see in the pictures can be compared and evaluated against each other. I trained my eye much more on the difference of the atmospherical neighborhoods in New York, where the architecture is extremely diverse. And I photographed in Harlem, which at the time really looked like a war zone. Some of the photographs that I made in Wall Street speak a lot about your pride and glory and the city of dreams.
I think he imposes a symmetry of his own onto these cityscapes. Somehow he gives them a weight, and that's actually what makes them interesting.
Having created his first serious body of work, Thomas decided to show his photographs in New York in the spring of 1978.
I made my first exhibition, The Streets of New York City, Central Perspectives, Thomas Struth. The pictures were just mounted on cardboard and glued on the wall without a frame. Some people came, and there was a lawyer, Henry Hacker. I think he bought six for $50 each. You gave me belief and trust that I could indeed become an artist. I always knew I'm an artist, but now I can say it, I'm becoming an artist.
After the break, Thomas Struth travels the world in search of new subjects and inspirations. Ideas. Expanding his career as a photographic artist, Thomas Struth took the skills he honed in New York and turned his lens to cities across the world. Only this time, he would experiment with color, scale, and new perspectives.
I think I photographed altogether maybe in 50 cities. I'm not really interested in the architecture per se. I was always interested in the unconscious energy of the community over a long period of time that expressed itself through the built environment.
In his cityscapes, he becomes the urban photographer. He's building one set of comparisons on another, on another, on another.
He's documenting this accelerated new civilization. It's an archaeology of the modern. The huge new cities that are sprouting up. There are now these monstrous towers thrown up without any regard for the environment, for community. They're frightening places. That sense of brutality and alienation is intensified by the sheer scale of the photographs. They are painting size. And so we read them almost like sculptures.
The next evolution in Thomas's work would come about almost by accident, when, during his travels, he thanked some of the families that hosted him by taking their portraits. He discovered that by turning his eye to the family unit, he could explore the preoccupations of his previous work on a more human level.
Most of the time, I take the pictures in the people's houses or in their environment that they know, that I ask people to find their place. I don't interact with that because I want to reveal something about the relationship.
For me, the family portraits are beautiful because there's a certain curiosity and there's a certain feeling of not feeling totally at ease. These people are definitely aware that somebody is taking a picture of them.
He's looking not at the individual and their social status. They're looking at the network of emotions and feelings and hierarchies within a particular family.
He brings all the generations of one family together, and there's a sense of equality. And when we meet them in the space of the galleries, it's almost as if we've entered their sitting room and we're on a one-to-one relationship with them.
For me, the family portraits are all like an epic story of that family compressed into one moment.
With his next project, Thomas developed the sensibilities of his family portraits in a way that would gain him international recognition. By examining the great art institutions of the world, his museum series raises questions about the nature of art itself and our relationship to it.
One gets very strong feeling that he's interested in the people. That's the main focus of the work, and that the art provides a kind of backdrop.
Some people go there because they want to see the art. Some people go there because they feel some kind of have to see the art. Some people go there because they've been dragged by somebody else. The museum now is an entertaining experience, just like going to a theme park.
Somehow I thought it would be great to be able to be the painting and look into the face of the observer.
I love the images where you see a whole group of strangers all enthralled in front of a single painting. It's marvelous, and it's my dream. I would love to have an exhibition which has the same kind of impact.
There's a great picture of his showing people in the National Gallery an altarpiece, and they are just looking at it, and the altarpiece itself is Christ and his disciples looking around him, looking at his wound, and it just shows how 500 years later, people still check out something to find some higher truth.
People have too much false respect. They're kind of in awe simply because these works are in the museum. When children get wild in the museum, the parents have like come down as if the artworks are authorities who say, shut up on yourself. And this is a very strange thing.
He's actually taking a very famous familiar painting, appropriating it, and then taking it into modern times.
So he's like laying his composition over the different compositions that have been already made by the curators in the museums.
In a radical departure from his previous work, Thomas turned away from human subjects and their creations and began to look at the natural world.
I thought Yeah, it would be interesting to make pictures where people have to keep looking because it's so detailed that they can never see all the details. Like they have to give up wanting to identify everything. And then I thought, well, I suppose it has to be a jungle.
It's not this long perspective that you have in the forest. It's really almost like a wall of leaves and stems and seemingly no system to it.
One of my best friends, who I showed the first picture, said, well, I'm afraid that looks like wallpaper. But I liked it very much. Yeah, I thought it was very interesting.
It's not just optical, it's physical. That sense of scale then immerses you in the world that he's bringing into the gallery. We forget the frame, the white wall, the building around us, and it's almost as if he's inviting us to step into these extraordinary worlds that he captures.
I think he did create a meditative surface, a meditative pattern in these forest pictures that is very soothing.
The paradise pictures are a kind of odd one. They were perhaps him taking a nice cold shower after all this human activity. You get back to a state of pure nature. After all, the clutter of cities, maybe looking at the clutter of paradise as well.
After the break, Thomas gives us a tour of his latest exhibition, and we catch a glimpse of his plans for the future. Always searching for new subjects to explore, Thomas Struth has most recently turned his photographic gaze to the high-tech environments and artificial worlds that surround us. The results can be seen at his latest exhibition, which premiered at the Martin Gropius Bau in Berlin.
My feeling was that since the beginning of the 80s, the accelerated manner of technology and science is in the process of overriding humanity. People should not be naive about it and should realize in every technology, you know, there's a political interest and there's a political direction. This is the first motif that you see upon entering the exhibition, which is one of the six Disneyland motifs. And it shows a movie screen where they show an aerial shot over California. The audience sits down on these benches, and when the movie starts, they become lifted up in front of the middle of the screen, and then while the plane or the helicopter is flying, the audience moves. I chose this as an opening picture for the exhibition, as an empty canvas for the fantasies that are about to come.
You look at a work of his that shows an artificial landscape from Disneyland, and you see nature despite the artificiality of all of it. Normally, when people go on a ride, they zoom by and they will hardly have time to look at all the details. But now you stand in front of a monumental picture and you have all the time in the world to just look at the details in this man-made world that is supposed to look so historical, and it's really only a few years old.
We make impressive things that are so complex and sophisticated that they become almost inhuman. And he shows us the interiors of a number of laboratories, strange alien places. We see an agglomeration of wires and tubes, and it's impossible to figure out what they do.
You know there's a system behind it, and you know there's science behind it. Many people, for many years, studied and explored and developed things to make it this way. Something very difficult a single person could never do, but society can do it. So the humanity is not in a phase, it's the humanity of things that are much higher than one single person.
This is a prostate operation. The surgeon sits away from the patient and operates the tools that are put into the patient. The technology is hovering over the patient.
but in a way also over humankind.
With the prostate operation, it affects the reproductive system. This is something really at the core of mankind. And we pinpoint some sharp tools and try to repair.
There's almost a kind of science fiction quality to them. They look fantastical and they're fascinating and we cannot pin them down. In other words, they look like art.
For the last 5 years, Thomas has been based in Berlin. His studio space, here on the Spree River, serves as an archive for his past works and a planning space for future projects.
Right now, I'm preparing a big show at Haus der Kunst in Munich. We're working on the archive of my becoming an artist. And we're trying to make the selections, go through all the material, and try to compose it, and then find the means to present it. This is drawings I made when I was 15, 16 years old, and that number 69 was my application number at the academy when I applied to become a student there. And, you know, this is all already, in a way, human figure and architecture. This is the floor plan of Haus der Kunst. When you start to think about an exhibition, you have the given space, which tells you how many works you need. The building is a fascist building. It's the building where the famous exhibition of degenerate art that Hitler opened in the 30s took place. So it's a very charged building. So it's a different responsibility to do an exhibition there. For an exhibition like this, the work maybe, yeah, like a year and a half or 2 years. It has to be brilliant and not only entertaining, but you change people's lives, make them think about certain things differently. There's a lot of lifetime flowing into this, so it has to be successful.
Running through his work, I think, is an absorption in the nature of human construction, of the kind of spaces that we create, the technologies that we make, and the sense of alienation that we create for ourselves. But without being either didactic or dramatic or sentimental, he stands back and he simply shows us what we are capable of. And that, I think, is his genius.
All of this is part of the human quest to strive for a better life. He is making pictures that sum up the history of mankind in some way.
It's about now, the recent past. He's showing the world, I mean, obviously through his particular perspective, but it's a world we can recognize. He does it in an understated way quite often, but sometimes understatement is a bit of a relief.
The future of my work is hard to predict. When people ask me right now, what are you working on next? I say, I'm thinking. But I'm just thinking, spending time thinking.
Brilliant ideas, powered by Hyundai Motor.